with the 2019 Gold Cup set to kick off in 5 days in the US. Men's national team's first game in 9. There are far more questions than answer for Greg Berhalter's team. More lifeless USMNT hammered by Venezuela in final pre-Gold Cup tune-up. The list of pressing queries includes, but is not limited to, the following. How is the midfield this bad? Put another way, in statement form, it's time to just build the midfield around Tyler Adams. While the defending left plenty to be desired in the Yanks 3-0 defeat to Venezuela on Sunday, the likes of Aaron Long and Matt Miazga were done no favors whatsoever by the pressure applied, or lack thereof by the midfield. Considering VEL Trapp, Weston McKennie and Christian Roldan comprised the starting midfield trio, the lack of pressure in the field's middle third is hardly surprising. Come to think of it, Tyler Adams is the only pressing artist in the entire player pool, but head coach Greg Berhalter has been pretty insistent on playing him at right back. Central midfield will almost certainly be Adams' long-term positional home, so why not stop wasting time in delaying the inevitable, turning the keys to the midfield and, by extension, the team to Adams. Without a press that opponents at least have to respect, opposing midfielders will continue to pick the USMNT apart with loads of time to pick a pass. Why not just start Altidore? Put another way, why isn't Josh Sargent on this team again? Sure, Berhalter wanted a bit more positional versatility with his final roster spot, but that can be at the expense of arguably the most promising center forward prospect the US has ever had. That seems short-sighted. More on that in a moment. If there is even a chance that Sargent becomes the starter at any point during his career, he should be on the roster for the first tournament of the new coach's tenure. Full stop. Seeing how he isn't on the roster, we'll stick to debating the players at Berhalter's disposal. Jozy Altidore should be starting, for a number of different reasons. We have no idea whether or not he can play in Berhalter's system, thus we need to find out. Playing without a capable center forward makes it difficult, if not impossible, to analyze the performances of any number of young attackers currently breaking into the team. His age when the 2022 World Cup kicks off 33. If we're not going to see Sargent alongside the other attackers he'll likely play with the next decade, let's at least give them a functional environment in which to operate and develop. What the USMN goal for this Gold Cup? Put another way, what exactly would you say we're doing here? Are we trying to win this particular tournament in the year 2019, or are we still focusing on the development of the next generation, which will, hopefully, take us to the 2022 World Cup in 41 months? Of course, if you were to ask Berhalter that very question, he would give some variation of the following answer, easier than us one in the summer. We're a young team, we need to gain tournament experience and learn how to win together, that's all too, and we'll see how strictly he sticks to that idea as the Gold Cup kicks often wears on, particularly when he's allowed to make a handful of changes to the roster between the group stage and the knockout rounds, assuming they advance, of course. Follow it and admits the Premier League transfer window is officially open again, and that means one thing, transfer reports are going to start kicking up a few notches. Video, Premier League highlights, here's a look at some of the latest gossip from around the PL. Corriere dello Sport in Italy say that Paul Pogba has agreed to move back to his former club Juventus, but the Italian champions will need to sell plenty of players to sign the Manchester United midfielder. Pogba, 26, joined United from Juve in the summer of 2016 for $110 million. But he had a topsy-turvy second spell at Old Trafford under Jose Mourinho, now Ole Gunnar Solskjaer. With Solskjaer linked with moves for multiple central midfielders already during the transfer window, it appears that if a suitable deal to move Pogba on can be made, he will be able to leave United. Juve will reportedly look to move on Mario Mandzukic, Joao Cancelo, Juan Cuadrado and Mattia Perin to fund the move, but there will be no rush on the move as they don't currently have a manga. Maurizio Sarri is expected to leave Chelsea to take charge of Juve in the coming days, and then Juve will be able to kick on with the transfer business for the summer. If United can get back most of the $110 million they spent on Pogba, that would be a very good deal. In an ideal world, they would get a little cash and maybe Paulo Dybala in exchange for Pogba. Although his displays picked up when Mourinho departed and Solskjaer arrived, the Frenchman's form regressed at the end of the season and he really is at the crossroads in his career. Does he stay at United and lead their rebuild in a possible return to glory? Or does he return to Juve where he can help them change for the European title alongside Cristiano Ronaldo and settle for the relative safety of winning Serie A year in, year out? Portuguese teenager Joao Felix is one of the hottest properties in world soccer and Manchester City is pushing ahead with their attempts to sign the Benfica midfielder. Benfica's chairman has admitted that Felix could be sold this summer, and Portuguese newspaper records say that Man City have offered wages in excess of $33.70 million over 5 years. The attacking midfielder is said to have a release clause of $133.10 million, but neither City nor Man United, who are also in the hunt for Felix, have triggered that clause. Felix, 19, was part of Portugal's squad which won the UEFA Nations League over the weekend, and his attacking prowess, close control and work ethic means he is perfect for Pep Guardiola's style of play. In many ways he's a younger Bernardo Silva, and with David Silva not getting any younger and Phil Foden yet to fully flourish into a first team regular, this is an area where City could strengthen. The figures are eye-watering, but Felix is one of the best young talents in Europe, and if City want to continue their domination they have to sign players of his ilk. With Leroy Sane potentially heading out of the door this summer, the transfer fee may not be as daunting as it seems right now. Follow at JPW_NBigSportsDay 4 of the 2019 Women's World Cup is here as Canada enters the tournament. More Women's World Cup news: the hosts from 4 years ago were knocked out in the quarterfinals on home soil and will fancy their chances of making a deep run in this tournament. Led by captain and record goalscorer Christine Sinclair, they face an underdog Cameroon side to open up group play. Argentina and Japan square off in Group D on Monday as England beat Scotland on Sunday to take control of that group. Japan are also favored to go far in this tournament and it will likely be between them and England to finish top of the group. Remember, you can watch every single game live online in Spanish via Telemundo Deportes. All you have to do is click on the links below. Live watch every single 2019 Women's World Cup game. Here is your full schedule for Monday, June 10 at the Women's World Cup. 2019 Women's World Cup Schedule Group D, Argentina v. Japan, 12 Uhr mittags. ET, Stream Live Group E, Canada v. Cameroon, 3 Uhr nachmittags. et Streamlive follow at jpw_nbigsportsankara Turkey AP Turkish officials have condemned the treatment its national soccer team endured upon arrival in Iceland ahead of the European Championship qualifying game. Turkey state-run Anadolu agency said the Turkey players were kept at passport control for more than 2 hours at Keflavik Airport on Sunday while their bags were repeatedly searched. The report said a man held a toilet cleaning brush like a microphone while team captain Emre Belezoğlu spoke to Turkish journalists. Foreign Minister Mevlut Cavusoglu wrote on Twitter the team's treatment in Iceland was unacceptable from the point of diplomatic and humane practices. Turkey moved to the top of its Euro 2020 qualifying group by beating World Cup champion France 2-0 at home on Saturday. More AP Soccer, https://apnews.com/app-soccer/twitter.com/app-sport. There is a lot of negativity swirling around the US men's national team right now. More big questions for USMNT after a 3-0 shellacking at the hands of Venezuela in their final tune-up before the 2019 Gold Cup begins. New head coach Greg Berhalter insists he is staying calm and isn't about to ditch his famed possession-based tactics following two disappointing defeats in friendly games last week. But the USMNT fanbase is already wondering one thing: do we have the players to play the way Berhalter wants us to? Right now, the answer is no, and with Berhalter unlikely to change his philosophy at all, it will be intriguing to see how this group of players adapt to these tactics throughout the tournament. Below is the team information I would play for the Gold Cup, but I understand that Berhalter's philosophy means it is very unlikely he will move away from playing for at the back. Still, with the current group of players he has, I'd go with a 3-4-3 formation to give the USMNT extra defensive solidity. JPW's best possible USMNT Ski for 2019 Gold Cup 3-4-3 Steffen Zimmermann, Miazga, Riem, McKennie, Adams, Bradley, Lovitz, Pulisic, Altidore, Holmes. Explanation: the team above gives the USMNT stability in defense while solving some of their problems in the fullback areas. Not having DeAndre Yedlin, John Brooks and Greg Garza available due to injuries is a blow and shouldn't be overlooked, but the fact of the matter is that there isn't enough depth in the fullback position for the USMNT. Loftsies should probably start at left back, but there is no decent option at right back, hence the system change to 3-4-3 from 4-1-4-1. Look, Berhalter loves to build a play from the back and having three center backs splitting wide in a midfield dropping deeper to pick up the ball should still work in this system. If anything, it will work better with the three ball playing center backs in this lineup. McKennie has played on the right a lot for Schalke, and in Berhalter's system he isn't as comfortable on the ball in midfield as he should be. Having him tuck in from the right flank makes sense, while the experiment regarding Tyler Adams at right back should end right now. He's the best high-pressing midfielder the US has, so he should be played in his best position, which is central midfield. Having the experience of Michael Bradley in midfield is a must. He should be allowed to create and join the attack whenever he can. Up top, Josie Altidore's presence is badly needed as a focal point, and Christian Pulisic should play off the right wing and be allowed to third forward and link up with Altidore. Dwayne Holmes has looked very good in his appearances for the USMNT and should start out left then drift in to support the attack. Punkt. Follow at jpw_nbigsports. Let's block ads. Why?